Through steadfast devotion to the gods of fear, time, and money, humankind was led to manifest a world colored by scarcity, competition, and sorrow.
Welcome to Simon on the Sofa. Yes, that's me. I'm Simon. This is the second time I've been on this sofa. You may have seen the conversation where I was with Charmaine and this wonderful woman, Lilia. Hey, Lilia.
How you doing?
Welcome to Simon on the Sofa.
Thank you for having me here.
Pleasure, pleasure, pleasure. I met Lilia some time ago. It was a good 2 years, maybe 2 years ago. We met up and she was telling me all about the letting go process and the Sedona method. And we just shared, you know, just touching base, just meeting new people as you do. It's 2016 and we're in the end of April. And we got chatting to Lilia and really just got to know her more in the last week. And I really wanted to share a conversation with her to bring that to the viewers of Simon on the Sofa. I know we've got so much we could talk about, but I feel what's really alive in us at the moment, isn't it? Mm-hmm. Is this around healing the human body, right? Mm-hmm. And what you also want to share in the world, because you've had an awesome journey. You can share me stories. We could be on here for 5 hours, right? So I think you and I are quite passionate at the moment about getting a message out there, you know, around healing and so on. So do you want to just fire off and we just dance?
For sure. Well, like we've been talking about, it's about helping people to love themselves or their selves, as anybody who knows my work will understand that I talk about everything from a cellular level. And when after I'd studied nutrition, I realised that I could tell people what to eat, but they didn't eat it. So I knew it wasn't about the knowledge. So I thought, what is that about? And that moved me into the mind stuff. And then I was lying in bed one night listening to Biology of Belief, and at my nutritional healing course, we'd talked about the structure of the cell and the cell membrane and the essential fats and the transport of information and the light and everything that goes to make a healthy, happy cell. And then Bruce Lipton was talking about his discovery and how the cell membrane, which is the wall of the cell, has a response or reaction to everything we feel, think, do. And suddenly this light went on for me. I was like, this is it. This is what the letting go is about, is when we can move into that state of acceptance, of non-resistance, energy can flow, light can flow, information can pass both ways. We transmit and we receive information. And it was just a huge aha moment for me. And from then on, that's how I taught my techniques. Yeah. I mean, I combine nutrition with letting go, because for me, you can't separate the two because they affect each other. And if you have, like we've talked about a lot this week, if people have a compromised digestive system, it changes how they feel. And if it changes how you feel, it changes what you think,
right?
And therefore what you do. So I have had to move back into the kind of nutrition world, which has, again, you've been listening to me, has been another voyage of discovery in terms of what I learned in my course, which was an incredible course. And it was much, much more than just food. It was about the planet and the alignment of the stars and the planets and the whole thing. And I know we share an intense love for the planet, and we understand that if we don't look after the planet, then we're not looking after ourselves, quite literally. You know, as above, so below.
Right.
So in that course, but within the food, helping people to choose not just a diet that we know will heal, but a diet that they can comply with, and techniques that they can comply with. Because it's, again, not about the knowledge. I don't think there's very many people truly don't understand that they can impact on their health and happiness. There may be some, but I think most of us really understand that we can make a huge difference, but we're not doing it.
Yeah.
And why are we not doing it, even when we know? And again, as we know, it's because of all the subconscious programming and the programming that we've had and the environment that we are in. So the internal environment, which comes from what we eat and what we think and say, but the external environment in terms of how, when I hang around with you, I'm going to be feeling high all the time because we're bouncing off each other and your energy's high as well. Whereas if you have a lot of people eating pizzas and maybe rolls and sausage, for an example, who are feeling negative, bitching about their workmates and, you know, not wanting to make changes and not wanting to exercise, then very quickly, when you're hanging around that environment, you stop doing the good things.
Right.
Because we're interconnected.
Yeah.
And we, you know, Lynn McTaggart talks in The Bond about how our brains will entrain when we go into mutually interesting conversation. The cells start to mimic each other.
Yes, I love
because
this.
Because although we appear to be separate, we're not.
Yeah.
And this is why the more of us that do it, the easier it becomes for all of us.
Yeah.
And, you know, I work with usually people who are allegedly terminally ill or allegedly incurably ill, words that I just don't believe are true for a lot of people. And but that strikes intense fear at a cellular level, which causes intense contraction, which of course changes the thinking. And my mission is to help people understand that there are so many things that you can do, and thousands of people are doing it and pulling back from quite literally death's door by instigating and inspiring and repeating these positive behaviours. Hippocrates said, commit enough daily sins against nature and you will experience dis-ease.
Yeah.
So what we're seeing is, well, let's unravel these sins and let's do the right things. Let's align.
Right.
Align on a daily basis. Even if you do it for, it doesn't need to be an hour, 10, 15 minutes, get back into alignment. But every day it's a practice, it's
yeah.
a discipline, and it has to feel right for you.
Yeah.
There are many ways to heal.
Yeah.
You need to find yours.
Yeah, and thank you for that. I'm glad you eloquently and articulately brought all that together, because we've been talking about so much. And Let's break some of that down, because mm-hmm. we know it's a new language, yeah?
Yeah.
And it's not, because you just quoted somebody of thousands of years ago, right?
Yeah.
So this is the dance that I'm always coming up with, is that, and you know me, report, I'm like, why don't people know this? This is simple, isn't it? It's like, surely everybody gets this. And obviously that's my sometimes a little bit sort of,
it's simple
yeah.
and it's free.
Right. It's simple and it's free, right? So we break it down. So first of all, I think maybe for people listening, because, you know, they may never, I just said the Sedona method, and some of my viewers definitely, they're from America and so on, they might have heard of Hal Dreiskin and the Sedona method. But also, I know, and you know, that everyone talks about letting go. So I'd love to just, like, we're just going to backtrack a little bit and then we'll dive into that, because I know it's all interlinked. So everyone talks about letting go, don't they? Like, I don't know, after a relationship, or, mm-hmm. you know, you hear people. I remember my ex-girlfriend, I used to say to her, just let it go. She just gets so knocked off with me saying, just let it go, right? And the irony was, is that, you know, when our relationship ended, also, I got a real sort of deeper lesson in what it really means to let go, right? It's like, yeah, you keep talking it, have a bit of it, right? Do you know, you're right? It was like one of those. So I'd love you just, like, from the way that you've been working with your clients and people and the training you've done, letting go, what is it, you know, what does that mean? What are we saying to people?
Well, letting go at a cellular level puts, if you imagine that each cell is like a 3D spider's web, it has little, what we call microtubules, like a cytoskeleton running throughout the cell. And when it's like a stringed instrument, that's the way I see it. And Sondra Barrett helped to expand on that. So when you're in tune, when the cells are in that state of harmony, and again, Bruce Lipton talked much more about the cell membrane, Sondra Barrett goes much more into the infrastructure of the cell, but it's all the same thing. We're either causing contraction or we're causing expansion.
Mm-hmm.
So when we stay in this state of tensegrity, which is, again, it's like the geodesic dome.
Right.
When everything's perfectly matched or weighted or measured, something will hold itself in place.
Yeah.
And, you know, we are, 100 trillion cells?
Yeah.
The magic of the body is beyond. It's just beyond.
Yeah.
The more I learn, the more awe that
yeah.
comes in.
Yeah.
So from a letting go perspective, when we have a judgment around anything, judging somebody out there maybe because in their haircut,
yeah.
if I thought their haircut wasn't right, I would
yeah.
judge them. Maybe it's their shoes. People do it with their watches, their handbag, you know, in the UK, that's a big thing. I'm sure it is in other places too. And or It might be because they eat a certain thing. That's right. The new spiritual thing. It's, you know, I do this, I do yoga. Yeah. Do you not do yoga?
Yeah.
So you're
Are you
judging.
Vegan? I'm not vegan.
Yes, exactly. So there's a, we're either, in terms of Sedona, we're either attracted or averted. So we're repulsed. So we're repelling or attracting right. all day long based on our programming and our culture, etc. So, and within that, as soon as we judge it, we create contraction. Mm. So the actual thing that we need to let go, we often clasp around at a cellular level and hold in.
Right.
And so because we are energetic, electromagnetic in nature, and we are emotional beings, so we can see something, we can experience the emotion, and then, like a child, the emotion would just stay maybe for a few seconds or maybe more if you're around 2 years old, and then it would just leave naturally. But as you get older, the conditioning to judge it comes in.
Right.
And we then contract and contract and contract, so we start to fill the beautiful empty energy body right. with all this garbage.
Exactly.
Primarily, it is a lot of rubbish that's in there. And we also now understand that we inherit, you know, some of our beliefs and past ancestral stuff, which most indigenous cultures are very aware of, that your ancestors are very important part of understanding yourself. But again, in the West, we've I don't know how we got so lost, but
I've got some beliefs I really just didn't choose.
Exactly. And you think, why did I do that? Or what? And you know, I think another huge revelation for me was, what is a belief?
Right.
Where did it come from? Yeah. Is it yours? Most of our beliefs
are not.
You can create and uncreate beliefs at will.
Yeah.
So why do you not believe things that make you feel safe and happy and secure?
Right.
Because once you start to kind of see through the energetic nature, you know, we are not solid. We are appear solid, but we know this is science, which a lot of people need and love. And I enjoy it as well, but I don't need it the way other people do. But if you take a cell and go down and down and down and down, it's 99.999999% space.
Yeah.
You know, they don't even understand why the cells hold together the way they do and why we appear. You know, we've never arrived. We're constantly going to be expanding. Yeah. So from the letting go perspective, ideally, we want to just clear this energy space again.
Right.
And
almost come back to like neutrality, come back to zero at least. At least go, oh, hold on, let me come back here and then start to make conscious decisions of what I want to bring in. Sorry, carry on.
No, but that's exactly it. From a healing perspective, which is clearly my passion, much as I love the law of attraction and let's create things and let's make things, why would you not do that when you're here? It's fun once you understand that you can do it.
Yeah.
But the big problem about the energy mass becoming like a hard drive of your computer, completely overloaded, loads of outdated information, loads of rubbish that's just actually quite literally in a metaphysical level slowing you down. And then when you get slowed down, you're struggling to do the things that you need to do on a daily basis, so therefore to try and ask you to do extra, i.e. let go or attract, it's just not going to happen because people are very bogged. And I include myself, you know, obviously we're a work in progress, but I do this every single day. I am passionate and obsessed about it because it's made such a huge difference to my life.
Yeah.
So the letting go is just deprogram.
Yeah.
Release everything. And then again, I don't know what people's beliefs are, whether they believe in God, the divine, the universe, a higher intelligence or power, it doesn't matter. There is an intelligence in this universe. And if you haven't noticed it, you must be blind.
Right.
It knows better than us. We can just be and we can allow and it's much, much.
Right, and there comes a huge like trust in that as well, right? Because we have to, in fact, that's a letting go right there. I wonder if there's like a short little thing that you can do with me, like for example, like can you find out if I'm holding on to something, or is there like because I'm probably going to just say yeah and let go quickly, because I like letting go too. But do you see what I mean? Because we meet, because for me, as you're talking, like I hear that, like we cling on so much, and you said, what did you say? No, you're either repelling or attracting, and I sort of came to it from meditation as craving or aversion, right? Uh-huh. So you're either craving something or averting, and either way, you know, that's taking you out of you know, your sort of equilibrium, your equanimity is taken out of your piece because, you know, you're being pulled, which is a bit like past future, right? You're being pulled one way or the other.
Exactly.
And I suppose, you know, I'm going to mention death because I've been mentioning it a lot in this last week, but in your experience, what have you come up across? Because whenever I talk to somebody about letting go, whether it be a belief, you know, their identity, the relationship, whatever, the idea that they were going to get the next flat or they were going to get the next job or whatever, you know, they're futurizing, you know, they have to go through an element of death, right? They have to die. So I don't know what you've experienced in that area where you've had to work with people letting go. If it's always just been plain sailing and they've just let go and it's like, yeah, get it, or, you know, that clinging on.
I think that's exactly it. That when I used to work with recovering addicts, and, you know, we judge and we label people, and for you, and quite often to do with addictions in our culture, but we're all the same. And we're all addicted at different levels, and we all have equal capacity to create an incredible life. Every single one of us. It doesn't matter how physically or mentally or emotionally able you are, the capacity to do it is there because it happens inside. And what stops you is your belief. And to take it back to healing, of course, when my friend's daughter was diagnosed with leukemia when she was 15, that was what kicked my journey off to do what I do now. The fear was just disabling. Mm-hmm. The fear for her. And then I had to, you know, I'm quite logical, so I thought, what's so awful about this? So there's two things. One, I didn't want her to die. She was 15. So I thought, right, what's death about? Because at that point, I was, what, 32? I didn't care about death. It wasn't going to happen to me for so long. You know, it just didn't really. I'd lost my aunt when I was 27, but at that point, she was 57. So I actually thought,
I've got a few more years. It's funny we do that though, huh?
Totally.
Yeah.
So then, and the other thing was the fear, the suffering that I watched her go through, and I thought, there's got to be another way. I didn't believe in God per se, but I thought whoever is in charge of this or whoever dreamt this up, I don't know how it happened, but I'm sure there's a better way than this. I just knew it innately that there was a better way to do it. And that then I made friends with death, and I'm really quite intrigued. Again, science. Where can energy go?
Right.
And then talking with Sandra Barrett, where she described the three stages of the cell. So you have the reproductive stage, you have the maturing stage, and then you have program cell death. And if you imagine that we're looking at the cells for information, realizing that, again, what's happening in here is happening out there.
Right.
Then we're like, okay, that's what we are doing. Are we maturing or programming cell death? And my belief is the way we're dealing with cancer, say, for an example, but any disease, is we do it in a very terrifying, scary way.
Right.
And we're doing it from a very one-dimensional perspective, which is the pharmaceutical way. If there's not a drug to fix it, then we see it's unfixable. And that just seems, with all the research I've done, and I'm sure to you as well, it's just like, that's ridiculous.
Yeah.
Because there are so many things that you can do. And it's not about living forever. Nobody can ever make any guarantees because nobody knows really how long you're going to be here.
Exactly.
But what we do know is that people are completely defying the odds, thanks to the amazing Kelly Turner, who wrote Radical Remissions. She interviewed the people and collated, as far as I'm aware, was one of the first people to actually do that. And 1,500 people that she interviewed said, nobody had ever asked them how they'd got well.
Wow.
So, you know, we're like, what is going on here?
Yeah, it's almost like we've got this, like, almost desire and addiction and habit to want to stay in that protective cell that you're talking about, in the fear, in the disease, right? We don't want to get well, right? Mm-hmm. That's what it feels like. And there's one thing before you go on, you just said something lovely, which I want you to touch on. When you talk about, because I loved it when you said this the other day, about the three things that the cell does. When we say programming cell death, so when we go as within, as without. So when we look outside and we know that we're reproducing like crazy, right? There's 7 billion of us, and that's gone like skyrocketed in the last, whatever, 100 years, yeah? So that's clearly happening, right? So when we go, like we're programming death, when we look out in the world and we see these diseases, or we see AIDS, or we see war, for example, mm-hmm. and we're a cell, you're 100 trillion cells or 60 trillion cells making up one cell, and then we're a cell, right? So I look out and I see cells, right? I see, like, bobbing around cells, like, what are them cells doing down there, you know, right? No, well, oh, there's a couple in a boat, look. How'd they get that boat? Well, that's cells too, right? it's like, it's a full-blown trip for me. But do you feel that's, like, that's a way of perceiving some of the craziness that's going on, not to condone war and condone disease, but is that our cells, you know, programming cell death? Are we saying, like, look, these guys need to, you know, they're just fighting each other and killing each other, and they're actually in a disease with each other? Uh-huh. You see how I'm seeing it?
Yeah, absolutely. That's exactly how I see it.
Right.
And what happens with a cancer cell, for example, is that the other cells don't recognise. It's the internal, the mitochondria that appears now to be the issue, but that's not obvious,
right,
to the cells. So therefore they get to reproduce out of control and can cause us serious danger,
right,
and take us out. And also the cells can do the opposite. They can start autoimmune, they can start kind of bringing each other in and then destroying them because they,
right,
they think, you know. So it's, again, it's communication,
right,
and the information is inaccurate, yeah, which is what we do.
Yeah,
you know, if you think of wars, it's all about communication.
Yeah,
wanting people thinking they're different from us, right, so therefore isolating them. We know, if you take it even to a personal level, when we put our old people into a home, for example, they can die very quickly if they're not happy there.
Right,
because at some level, they're right, okay, there's no point in me being here anymore.
Right, it's like so they've been cast
subconscious,
down.
Yeah. Yeah, they've subconsciously programmed cell death. And also, we've seen studies where they take them out of the home and back into the family and they, yeah, come to life again.
Right.
We all need, you know, that's the other thing really took from Sondra's presentations was the cells collaborate.
Mm.
Clearly, they've collaborated to make me and to make you.
Right.
You know, in a way that's just genius. And we know if we pull together, we can do, have, be, see anything we want.
Right.
That's the potential for human beings. So why are we not doing that?
Yeah.
Why in the health world are we not collaborating with the science and the spiritual?
Yeah.
You know, why are we saying to people there's nothing else we can do when there is?
Yeah.
Anybody that's got the internet should know. You know,
there's evidence and it's happening.
Yes, there's data for this.
Yeah, so in like, because you've been exploring this for a number of years, I know you sort of do see a change, but are you seeing a change, or are you seeing that sort of fear, that closure is, you know, there's like almost a battle going on, or are you seeing an opening? Because I still, for me, my perspective, you know, when I meet someone like you and others, yes, it's like yes, 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 it's yes. But again, I mean, it's minority, right? Even on the level of some people that have been in the so-called maybe self-development, personal development, spiritual, whatever, you know, realm you want to call it, it's still, you know, there's no collaboration going on in some of those realms, mm-hmm, right? Even with the love, which we know love is all inclusive, there's no separation. We know that sense of feeling, right, where we're just connected. And yes, then people talk about, you hear a lot of people saying, we are one, right? But we are one. What does that even mean to get into the, activate the concept of we are one, yeah, right? Do you see, exactly, what I mean? So I don't know what's happened for you in that field.
Well, yeah, it feels like it's still very niche. That's why I love being in Malta, because pretty much everyone I talk to here feels and believes the same as I do, and that's probably why I'm so at home here. But certainly when I go back to the UK now, the course we had with Sondra was incredible. Everybody in the room got it, clearly. People that would turn out for something like that. So I think there's, as far as I can see, there's the people that are starting to open their minds. For some reason, people don't like you to even question, is there a better way than chemotherapy and radiation?
Right.
Why are we not allowed to ask that? Surely we understand that we're progressing, we're doing incredible feats beyond, you know, your wildest dreams. So why can we not question the fact, let's try and find a less toxic way to treat the body? The body is communicating something.
Right.
And it's probably been knocking for quite some time, and you've not been listening because we're too busy, and we've, you know, the government has to play their part. People are trying to pay their bills and their overheads and their mortgages, and insurances, and you know, that's one of the reasons I left the UK. It was overwhelming.
Right.
The amount of things that you have to do in order to run your home.
It's almost like as you're talking, I'm like, it's almost like those cells. You know, again, they're planning that, right? It's not about going, it's the government. It's this, but like the cells are planning that to stay alive, to stay in their damn things. Like, let's create distraction for these cells over here. You know, they can just stay in their suffering and disease.
Exactly. So all of that, I was just like, how can we possibly change this? And of course, then when I moved here, I realised it's not about changing. It's not about trying to change the systems as they are. It's about creating ones that work for the people.
Mm.
Because I think we all know who benefits. The small minority at the very top are benefiting from the systems as they currently stand.
Right. And so, you're talking, when you say that, just for people listening, we're talking about, and this isn't about to get all conspiratorial, but we know that, you know, the pharmaceutical company creates a drug. You know, this is evidence out there now, right? That people that work in the pharmaceutical companies come out and share what's happening in there. It's like not hard to find. And that when these drugs get put on the market, that you know, if depending on the route of how they've got there, they have to go. And then the doctors have to give that one out regardless of what's happening, because that's the new drug that has to be sold, right? Yes. So you've got all of this going on when we're going in there thinking that we're going to a doctor and we're getting his heartfelt, you know, check. This is not a put down on doctors. I've got friends that are studying to be doctors, et cetera, et cetera. But the point is that there's a lot of them that lose their mission to actually want to help, don't they? Because they get caught in a system that stops them from having the empathy.
Yeah, well, they don't talk about health, they treat disease.
Right.
And that's the, most people when they go to the doctor, and I have to say it's consumer driven as well. People don't want the doctor to say, well, change your diet and go and exercise.
Yeah.
You know, and go to the church and connect with your, nobody wants that prescription.
Right.
And, you know, doctors have, I think, 7 minutes or something like that in the UK, and you know, a lot of people just need to talk. You know, we know that people are going to the doctor because they're so lonely.
Right.
They're going for some connection. So there's a whole lot of social issues around it. But primarily my passion is the people that are getting diagnosed as being terminally ill when I absolutely know a lot of them are not.
Yeah.
And we need to change the way that when the body starts to create a lump or a rash or a temperature, it's usually trying to heal, that we call it the healing crisis. So we just have to go, right, okay, what is this? What's the body saying? There's a language. This bundle of intelligence is on your side. Mm-hmm. It's malfunctioned because of the things that you're doing in it, on it, or to it. And when we understand that, because a lot of us, and again, I include myself, it's an unconscious thing. We don't realise we're mindless about the body.
Yeah.
And then when you start to go, oh my God, so much fun to be had here when we start to understand. And the peace, you know, when I started the Sedona method, was my first emotional release technique. The peace I got from that, and it turns out that's all a lot of us want,
right?
It's peace.
Yeah.
And when you can help somebody to let go and move into peace just for now,
right,
just in that moment, the cells just go into that state.
And it's so nice, isn't it? You know, when you do a letting go process, I can't, what's the one saying that I love that Hal says? It's like, you know, first of all, can you let go, isn't it, right?
Could you, would you, when?
Yeah, could you, would you, when? And then what's lovely is that he often does this on the videos that I've listened to, is that they go, no, no, no. He's like, okay, can you be okay with that you don't want to let go? Mm-hmm. Yes. Okay, great. Right, isn't it? That's described quite well? Because then in that moment, they're like, oh, well, there you go. And then it's like, it's super funny because it's like we're holding on so much. And actually, I know we're moving into now the sort of the area of the terminal ill. But, you know, what do you feel like? Sometimes people are holding on to their disease, right? This is what I want to mean. They're like almost the cancer at times, or whatever the disease is giving them an identity. And then that identity, that illness, they almost like they get the connection sometimes. They get the sympathy. They get the world, you know, so then they don't want to let go of the potential of like, who are they without the disease? Yeah, I don't know. That's just coming up to me now, but that's something.
Absolutely. There's a whole industry and a whole belief system that is culturally ingrained in us now. And this is, I suppose, why what I'm trying to kind of open people up to if they want to. But if you are sick, even if you're not sick, because let's face it, most people need some healing in this planet because it is so polluted. So, you know, just talking about holding on, when, you know, we know we need to let go, because you can't heal often, and you can put as much good nutrition in as you want and herbs and supplements, but if you're holding on at this deep cellular level and the energy can't flow, that'll take you out. And we again, we don't really address the emotional stuff in our in the allopathic system, because it isn't time. And until recently, we've not really fully understood how important it is.
Yeah.
And I think that's an understanding that's definitely coming. And again, to quote Sondra Barrett, with I can't remember the name of the doctor that she asked about the, you know, the cancer patients that recovered. And he said that they often let go of something big. And that can
when they recovered.
Uh-huh, and then they recovered. Because often we need to, but often we're too scared to, because we're too scared. And I've seen this in Sedona, and I've said this to you before. People go, they fly to Sedona, usually halfway across the world, to let go, and they won't let go.
Yeah.
And you're like...
They've booked the flight, they've paid for the thing, and they still
and they've read the book, and they've done the CDs, and they've had the experience.
Yeah.
And it's kind of like, why? Let go.
Yeah.
Because if you don't like, there's never anything to lose, because you can pick it up again if you don't like the feeling of freedom and bliss and joy.
Yeah, totally.
You know? And that fascinates me. But then again, Sondra and I talked about it in depth, because again, if you go back to the three stages, are people scared if they completely let go that they're going to die?
Right.
Is that the ultimate
choice the ultimate...
to leave the body? Yeah. Which we know, again, in Indigenous cultures, and I know that my friends... when he did his PhD with an old Ugandan man who was, they didn't know his real age, but it was near 130. And he just went to, he said, well, that's me now. I'm away. And he chose to leave the body.
Right.
So, I mean, that is contrary to everything we believe, because we're so busy fighting death and we don't want to go there. Nobody does. And we're holding on because, and is it just simply because of our beliefs? The beliefs around something that's, we're all going.
Yeah.
Let's face it, I think we should make peace with that. And again, with allegedly terminal ill patients, because I don't like that word. I think we need to get that out of the healing space. But ultimately, we're all going to cross. That's how it would appear. We're going to change form to whatever that may be. So let's look at that. Don't be scared to look.
Yeah, because actually, this is a nice... I like this, because we said this the other day, right? We said that you get a disease, so you get terminally ill, whatever it is, right? Cancer. And then all the fear comes up, yeah? And like you said beautifully the other day around that then the doctors and other people and the experiences you've had with your father and so on, they almost pummel on this fear, right? Like you get told that you think you're deaf. You don't even understand there's different stages. You just think, oh God, deaf. That's it. They told me, you know, my father died of bile duct cancer. Yeah. And he got told he only had 4 months to live, and he started the chemo and he died within 4 months. Yeah. Less than that. Mm-hmm. I didn't know him, but I got to speak to him once, twice, briefly before he died. And, you know, the chemo wiped him out and so on. Now, also, he was at a stage where, you know, I wasn't in connection with him, but had I sent him a whole heap of stuff, he probably wouldn't have even done it anyway. It's almost like, you know, he'd been given his sentence. But the reason why I'm bringing this up, when you talk about death, is it just that we're so damn scared, we're such in terror of life anyway, just like, you know, that we're so constantly, subconsciously maybe on this. I'm just throwing this out there, see what you feel, what comes up. Subconsciously, we programmed ourselves that we're so damn scared of dying, that one, this might be why people don't want to speak about death, because they just don't. Mm-hmm. And two, when you get a disease, a bit like Charmaine said, rather than it thinking, oh, it's death, it's all over. I mean, she's even said on some of the things she's posted that she's living now more than she's ever lived, mm-hmm. right? She feels more alive now than she's ever lived. So maybe again, have we got maybe a bit of a warped perspective of what this so-called terminally ill death means?
Well, yeah, I think that's a brilliant and very valid point, because ultimately, a lot of people are just going through the motions of living. And so therefore you're maybe in a job that's really not serving you. I mean, how many people do you know are just loving what they do?
Right.
And we spend a lot of time at work.
Right.
And then there's the kind of relationships within the workplace, because in actual fact, that's probably what I see, apart from your relationships in your home. Are they all serving you? Because what I see is people are tired.
Right.
Really tired. So you try and put anything extra, ask them to do anything extra, they're just, I can't do anything else. They're almost just like keeping their head above right. the surface as it is. So therefore, to try and get them to quit their job, move out of the relationship, you know, sometimes that's just terrifying for people.
Yeah.
The amount of people when I moved here that said, well, you were so brave. And I didn't feel like being brave to me. I knew I had to move out of the UK because I was getting so negative about yeah. everything there. And so I was like, I need to remove myself from this because it wasn't good for me. But so, and that's what you ultimately have to do.
Yeah.
If you're unhappy, you're getting told something.
Right.
Exact same way as if you're happy, you're getting told this is right. Yeah. You're unhappy, this is wrong. Now I'm not saying like quit your job and chuck your relationship. And, you know, I'm saying look and see what it is yeah. you know, that needs to
exactly.
change.
And you are inviting change though. And that's and actually maybe we should just talk a little bit about change, right? Because again, if we're talking about the fear of death, mm-hmm. we know now that even in polls and surveys that some of people's deepest fear is change, right? And I know we laughed on this the other day, but it has to be brought up, and I love bringing that up for people listening to us today, is that, like, Lilia, it baffles me how we can be scared of change when the only damn thing happening on this planet is change. Like, you know, and that's not, I don't care what anybody says, the body is changing constantly. Whether you can see your cells, dead cells dropping off here, like we've left a few on here, you know what I mean? That, all right, that all over the place. I'm probably throwing a few on you right now, right? We know we're changing constantly. We're maturing, we're evolving. We know that this room might look the same, but I know full well that it's changed since yesterday, right? That cup was, you know, and so on and so forth. So we know that. So again, it's like, we seemingly seem so stupid to not be able to embrace change. And I think that's what you're saying. Everybody thinks it was brave for you to move, mm-hmm. but you just thought, no, I had to move. It was for my well-being or whatever. Mm-hmm. Because deep at their core, again, they want to do that, right?
Yeah.
But they can't, anyway, that's just coming up for me, just this fear
stories,
of damn change.
You know, we make up stories like you and I have talked about as well, and justification for why we can't make change. And I think, if you understand the conscious mind and the subconscious mind. So we have the conscious mind that says, right, on Monday, I'm going to eat healthily and I'm going to go to the gym. I'm going to be nice to my cat or my mother or my father. Okay? But the program that's in the subconscious mind is not that. Mm. That's not what you normally do. So you have two minds. As soon as you take your eye off the ball, you will do what you always did.
Right.
Because that's how it works.
Yeah.
So when you realise that we have to get these two minds into alignment.
Right.
So what I do is, on a Monday, I get up and I go to the gym and I make my smoothies and my juice. And if that's what you always do, then that's fine. The program's in, you don't think about it.
Right.
That's what you do.
Right.
So it's getting the two minds into alignment. And to do that, well, what the way I teach is obviously we use the conscious mind to create for goal setting and positive affirmations. And
right.
And to see what we would like our beliefs
yes.
To be. Mm. And then we release everything that stops us from that. And it's usually a process that can take as little as a few days. It depends how determined, what's your intention?
Yes.
Are you going to get this? Are you going to do this? How much do you want it?
Yeah.
And again, your support network as well. Keep talking about the support network. Hang
Good.
Around with other people that...
Yeah.
Believe you can heal, believe you can do change, believe you can be yeah. the best you can be, because it makes it easier.
Yes.
That's because the cells mimic, da da da. And it's the reason it's so much easier to do what you always did is because that's the program that's there. You can do it quite literally without thinking. That's
yeah.
what a subconscious behavior
exactly.
is.
Exactly. And it said 95%, right?
95%
is, you know, the iceberg analogy, boom. 95% is your subconscious and five. And so why would we not, I want you to continue, because I know you've got more, but, and also we wasn't taught how to even play with that, right? We weren't even shown, like, hey, your conscious mind, you have only 5% of it, but you know what? You can actually take responsibility and reprogram your subconscious mind so that it does the things that you really want it to do. But hey, good to know that, isn't it, at 10 years old, okay? Now you go out into the world, nobody tells you full stop any way of, like, you know, reprogramming.
Interesting you should say that, actually. I got a really nice message from a young girl that used to work with me, thanking me for, because I introduced her to you know, the law of attraction, and how she could always, how everyone, I used to teach everyone that worked with me, you know, to set goals and to really follow their heart's desire and how they could let go. And of course, some take it on, but it was so nice because it's like maybe 10 years later she wrote and thanked me for that.
Yeah, you didn't have contact. And she was just like, hey, you have.
Just out of the blue, yeah, actually, I need to message her back and say thanks because it's so nice to hear that. But yes, of course, we know, we watched that video with the bike the other day, right, and how an adult took 8 months to do something that a three-year-old learned in 2 weeks. Yeah.
This is the bike, just so you know, you might have seen the video. It's the bike where the handlebars are set up differently.
Back to front,
yeah. And if you've not seen it, it's super cool. Maybe I'll put the link under here, because Lilia just found it. I watched it a couple of months ago, and Lilia just found it again.
And it's just a really great example of how we, how we're conditioned. It's like, for example, if I said to you, unlearn how to walk.
Yeah.
Well, first of all, you wouldn't want to.
Right.
And it would, but people do. They have accidents and then they have to learn how to walk again.
Yes.
So these behaviours that we've repeated and learned are in the subconscious, and they stay there for a very good reason. Driving a car. You don't want to forget how to drive your car halfway to the airport. You know, so these things that we've learned and put in there, but we understand that when they're going in very young, because the kid's brain's on theta state and they're just learning, like little, you know, that's when to teach them.
Yes.
You know, and this is, of course, it has to come into education. As in now we've got these really emotional children coming in and, you know, bullying and problems at school and people, you know, suicide at a horrific rate. And we need to teach people how about this.
Yeah.
How to deal with it and how to let it go and how to, you know, use the imagination.
Right.
Where there is no limitation.
Nice.
That's where the miracles and the magic
imagination
happen.
You allow your imagination where there's no limitation. I like that.
Because the conscious mind will limit you. And, you know, so if you decided, right, okay, I want to see naked retreats in every country, or maybe choose a few continents, and you can see it and you can visualise it and you can get the vibe for it. But then the conscious mind will come in and say, well, don't be so ridiculous.
Yeah.
How are you going to do that?
Yeah.
And, you know, where are you going to get the money, or where are you going to get the people, the resources, and blah, blah, blah. So, therefore, it's very, very easy to totally quell that fire, that passion. I know for you that wouldn't happen. Because
but there's still limitations come even with us, right, when we're on full power, but go on.
So when you actually just go, you put it out there, and again, this is Sedona method, you put it out, this is what, you know, for me, I want to raise the vibration of the planet. I want to work with the top healers in the world. I want to be one of the top healers in the world. And I want to run retreats in amazing healing locations all over the world. Well, it turns out these things are already starting to happen for me.
Exactly.
So, but impatience and doubt and procrastination. Yeah. And
it's not linear, I want to throw in there as well, right? It's not linear, but continue.
Exactly. So the linear time's the biggest problem we have.
Yeah, exactly.
Because the linear time's like, how long have we got to live?
Yeah.
The linear time is like, is it Monday again? I've not done this and I've not achieved this.
Yeah.
So we've got this.
Which is fear, right? Which is fear communicating.
Totally.
That's the protective cell.
It's fear and time doesn't even exist.
Exactly.
It's a construct of the conscious mind.
Right. And again, using this cell, because I love how we're just using this as a whole cell. Again, for people listening, just even the concept of that has been activated by everybody has come from that cellular, or I'm saying this, has come from the cell that's in fear and worry and, you know, doesn't know what to do without it. So it's actually come from that, you could say, almost negative, fearful aspect, right? Hence why it's causing so much damn problem with our manifesting skills and all this other stuff. But please, continue.
That is exactly it. And this is, you know, going back to that from the cellular perspective, if you have a very poor diet, or if you've had a lot of stress, and if you've not been in trust and not been in love in your relationships, etc., the cells may well be programming cell death. They think something's dreadfully wrong,
right.
And the body can quite literally, you know, start to get into this state internally, which drags the thinking down. And when we think things, and I know we both teach this, we believe some of the stuff that we...
Exactly.
And here's the other thing. Today, 99% of what we thought yesterday.
Right.
And the day before.
Right.
And the day before.
Yes.
And here we are, this amazing amplifier for life.
Right.
And we are just recycling.
Yeah, it's like, as you're talking, I'm going like, as you said that, I sort of like, you know, we say the transmitter and the receiver, right? And we're just like, you know, I want us to just touch on the electromagnetic field, because I love how you describe that as well. And we're this electromagnetic field, we're this pulsating 100 trillion cells of full intelligence, right? I'd start vibrating myself in a minute, yeah? And then you look out in the world, and all I see, you know, and this isn't a judgment, this is an observation, is dead people walking. These are divine expressions of pure life force intelligence, which are having an impact and an effect on life regardless, even if they don't realize it. And bless us, and this is not by any means to condemn anyone, right? This is an observation. A judgment is like condemning. I'm not condemning, this is not putting people down. It's saying, I'm like, you know, you don't meet many people, and you say to them, Lilia, how are you feeling? You don't even meet many people going, amazing, awesome, phenomenal, grateful. I'm the only one that I hear saying it. When I hear somebody else say awesome, I'm like, yeah, dude, awesome, good to meet you at last. I'm vibrating not bad, all right, yeah. How are you feeling? Well, you know, so-and-so the other day over there, got this, got that the other, you know, yeah, well, could do with a bit more money. Work's not the greatest, but it's okay, you know, it's serving, it's paying the bills. I'm like, come on, we need some aliveness here. It's like, I'm alive, I'm here. I made it through 200,000 sperm cells. I got in, I done the race. I'm here, look at me, I'm a pulsating atom. It's like, you know, I'm like, come on, let's have a drink. Yeah, look at this elixir. It's water. I'm made of water, you know, whatever. I'm going off on one, but, you know, just buzzing. Like when you see somebody walking down the road and they're dancing a bit, like a little bit of a, you know, bouncing it, people look at them and go, oh, good, what's up with him? Is he, he's all right, I want to put him down because he's having fun, right? Anyway, I'm just go off because you put your arms up and I just thought, yeah, where's that spark of aliveness?
Where is the life?
Yeah.
But I, again, going back to the UK, because, I mean, I don't see it so much here because so many of my friends live like the way we do, and they, you know, so, but I see the system, you know, controlling people much more. I know it happens in Malta too, but just not quite so much where I hang out. So, you know, so I do judge the government. I'm like, what are you doing to people? You know, somebody like me has very entrepreneurial spirit. I was lucky, the family I was brought up in, and so loads of ideas and creativity, etc. And it just seems that they crush that spirit, you know, and if you can crush my spirit, then you're going pretty...
But also, they're not consciously knowing they're doing it,
are they?
No,
I don't think
this
they
is do. Because, again, it's what I love about the cell, the way we're dealing with this on a cellular level, right, is that we're bypassing the judgment of, like, it's, you know, them or that. But we're saying that how can these cells, or I'm saying this to you now, how can these cells that you know are either in... programming death, or they're in the closure of the fear, cortisol in the body, you know, everything that comes along with that, you know, they're suppressing themselves. They put themselves in them environments. Sometimes they do go there with high intentions, and maybe they're full power and they're like, I'm going to go in there, I'm going to make a difference, I'm going to help the people. And then after a while, they get pounded on. And then you're actually, it's almost sometimes we, the people, are putting out this hope that the people that are over there, these cells that are actually in protection, death, closure, and all this other stuff, are going to somehow create new systems of aliveness. Do you see what I'm pointing at?
Yeah.
It's like they can't do it.
Well, this is that we've given our power over. And apparently this is one of the things of democracy, where it's very easy to say, well, we'll put really clever people in and then they'll do all the work and we don't need to do anything. So we take our eye off the ball, and again, the law of unintended consequences. And it's the same has happened in the system. If you look at the education system, the law, the health system, which is my kind of main thing, and of course the political system, the banking system.
Oh yeah.
You know, we allowed it, and then suddenly it just all went haywire, and we're seeing the system
break down. Because it's crumbling, right? Aren't they? They're breaking down big time.
And I think ultimately, and I even see it within a smaller, like in companies and in businesses. You know, before we employed people and we managed people, and that's becoming more and more of a challenge now. And that's personally why I got out of it, because it wasn't serving me any longer, or it wasn't serving me or my staff. Because, you know, to run a business, there's a certain things that have to be done. And then if they don't get done, then you have to go down to the staff, da, da, da. And then I thought, you know, I think this model's dying, where we're actually, and I think it has to, people have to take responsibility.
Yes.
Why should I be the one in my business, for example, that has to deal with the banks and all the stress and all the hassle, and you get the money paid, you're getting your money paid into your account, and maybe you've not done what you're meant to do, mm-hmm. but there's no, it's okay for you to do that because you're going to get the money anyway, whereas me, I have to take all the stress. Whereas now what's happening, people are kind of, you know, 0 hour contracts, and I know that's controversial, and I can understand it's much nicer to be secure, but let's face it, what is security?
Exactly.
Taking responsibility for yourself and your health.
Right.
You know, back in the day when you had to pay for your own health, maybe you looked after it a little bit better.
Right.
You know, now we perceive that healthcare is free. It's not. We pay for it.
Yeah,
of course we do.
Yeah.
So, and in the States, interestingly enough, you know, if you actually have to go and pay for your chemotherapy, and you actually do have to pay, then maybe, you know, it's, I believe we should all have free access to healing. Don't get me wrong on that. But I'm just saying, again, if we think something's free, we start to abuse it often and take it for granted.
Yeah.
So I think we really need to address that, whether it's in our relationships, any relationship, there's a working relationship, a friendship or a love, you know, a sexual relationship, whether it's in our job, whether it's in our whatever, we need to take responsibility.
Yeah, which is wonderful, because that's, I just want to throw that out there for people listening. Responsibility, and maybe you can just remember a little bit of what we spoke at the table this morning before our call, because that was just another beautiful conversation with you. But responsibility, very simple for everybody listening. The ability to respond. That's it. Just the ability to respond, not react. Mm-hmm. And when it comes to like everyday life, healing, what's going on in society, etc., it seems that we're just reacting, you know, constantly. Yeah, so I don't know if that, I just wanted to throw that in there again. I like to, because we throw so much out there, and I love it for when people are listening, just to like really break those down. Like you just said, why don't we take responsibility for our health and just our, it's almost like we've put all of our focus, you know, because we come from that place of fear and pain and ownership and protection and everything else associated to that. And we lose the very, you know, the very core essence of what we should be putting our focus on, which is our health and our well-being, right?
And I think that's why a lot of us are lost and unhappy. Because in actual fact, when we know from HeartMath, when you give back, you get, create a stronger resonance and a stronger feeling of worthiness. And I think we've kind of lost that because we covered the soil with tar and concrete because we don't have time to tend the garden. The food that actually gives us life. We're in jobs that we don't want to be in because we have to pay a mortgage. That's another sort of whole thing. We stay in relationships now, and I know in the economic crisis in the UK, people, they had to stay in the same house because the economy didn't allow them. Their houses had plummeted into negative equity.
Right.
They couldn't sell them. Right. So the trap, you know, you were really quite literally trapped. And that's sort of how they keep us there.
Suffering.
Uh-huh. So say, for example, you see an ex-boyfriend or girlfriend or something, or that you were still in love with, and you see them, and your body will react.
Yes.
Because there's an electrical current that comes either from the memory, or the visual. The visual. So it's quite literally like lightning. Thoughts are electrical in nature.
Yeah.
So that. The memory will come in, or maybe it's a perfume or an aftershave or something, and boom, that heartache is in the body.
Okay.
Nothing's actually happened, maybe, but the feelings there are triggered by the memory.
Right.
And everything, of course, in the past is now a memory. No longer really exists apart from in our memory bank. So we basically use the letting go techniques to unhook that electrical charge.
Right.
From that memory.
Yeah.
And this can work with, you know, good memories. They're all variations of memories. It might be, for example, if you had a bad car crash at some place, it could be that place that will trigger the memory. So all we're doing is you don't forget, you just no longer react, you respond. And that is a process that happens quite naturally over time. You know, it gets easier, but what the techniques allow you to do is get there much faster.
Yeah.
So you pan back and you observe and you release that electrical
right
reaction. And that's, of course, been stored in the subconscious mind.
And that can be that, and just to ask a question in that, can that be also just for a four? Because I have that sometimes with a four, so I don't see the person. It's in relation to my ex-girlfriend. I don't see her, but still the way that we parted, I wasn't fully happy, and we haven't spoken, right, for a long time. Mm-hmm. And that thought still stays with me. And I've been doing letting go on it, and I've cried, and I've done emotion on it, and all this stuff, shaking, and you know, mm-hmm. they're doing the things. Techniques. And still, every now and again, it pops up. Now, it has got less, admittedly. Mm-hmm. So is that what you mean? So it doesn't have to, it's like I don't have to see her, right? It literally can just be that thought.
And that's what I would do with someone, is take them into the memory to see what the body says.
Right.
So think of your ex and listen to what the body says. Because that information's stored in there.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the reaction.
Right.
And then we release on the reaction. And sometimes it'll go in one. Sometimes you need to keep practicing. And what we tend to do is out of sight can be out of mind. So you maybe work on it for a little bit and then you stop. But if you keep working on it, you can release the attachment. That's the attachment.
Attachment, great word there.
That we have to these things. And it's the same with food, because I do a lot around that. So wine, bread, crisps,
sugars,
chocolate.
Yeah, standard.
Pasta.
Alcohol.
So if these are the things that you're like, I want that thing.
Craving.
And it's good to do it when the craving's high.
Yeah.
And then you can release that craving because it's not real.
Yeah. And what did you do? You said something on that the other day that you sometimes do with that.
Do? I'll get the picture up in my laptop of the foods that people crave, you know, their favourite go-to food, and release that electrical charge. It's the exact same process. It doesn't matter what it is. You're having a feeling, and that feeling is making you believe and think that you need to do something. So it's thought, feeling, action.
Right.
So thought, maybe the feeling could have been, you know, brought in by anything.
Right.
It might even just be that you're a bit tired.
Yeah.
The feeling comes in.
I'm gonna have a smoke.
I need a sandwich or I need a glass of wine or whatever, and then that follows through to the action.
Yeah.
So with Byron Katie, obviously the work, we work at the thought level, where the electricity happens. And with the Sedona method and EFT, we work more on the energy, emotional level, and really release the emotion. So when the emotion goes, the thinking will change. And that's very often people say to me, what happened there? You're a witch. Because in that instant of release, the thinking matches the emotion.
Right.
So if you release up to here, suddenly you're like, looks a wee bit different. You release up to here. In the Sedona method, we work with 9 different emotions, 6 contracted, 3 expanded.
Right.
And then when you come up to here, where I'm just using this as an example.
It's okay, yeah.
These are the expanded emotions.
The 3 at the top.
So the solution comes in here. You go back down here, the problem comes back. So if somebody has a negative emotion in their body where the cells are contracted, and they'll say to me, I don't know where to start, I've got so many problems. But you're not, you have the emotion, the problem is the emotion.
The one problem.
Uh-huh. Yeah. So everywhere you look, when you've got that emotion in, there'll be a problem.
Wow.
You know.
Yeah,
so when
totally
you release that, ping, suddenly you're like, oh.
Yeah. I see the world more clearly.
Yes.
Yeah.
I always say it's like when you leave Glasgow Airport and you go up through the clouds, and suddenly the sky's blue.
Right.
The sky's always blue.
Right.
But you can't always see that.
Yeah, and I love that so much because I'm so glad you described it like that, because often people go, they have an awakening or a peak experience, which ultimately is a letting go, right? Letting go of a whole heap of beliefs, yeah? And when I had a peak experience, it's actually, oh my God, I can let go of all these damn beliefs around needing to be famous, needing to be rich, needing to be somebody, you know, and all this other stuff just fell away almost instantly and gave me a glimpse. And then I looked out the window. It's the same window in Camden Town that I'd been looking out all year, right? It's not like the window changed and everything, but
exactly.
It's purely the way that I was viewing reality changed, yeah? That's exactly what you're talking about, yeah?
Absolutely.
So when people say they've had an awakening, and I often say, they feel enlightened, I normally describe it that enlightened means weightless.
Yes.
You've dropped off a whole heap of crap that you've been carrying with thoughts, feelings, emotions, and physical stuff often as well, right?
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Yeah, I love that.
It's completely that, because that stuff has a weight, a metaphysical weight, and when you let it go, you start quite literally to get lighter. And lighter, not just physically lighter. I mean, people will say suddenly the colours are brighter.
Right.
Everything
exactly.
looks, and you feel love.
Yeah.
And, you know, let's talk about taking things personally, because that's a big thing that I work with, is are you taking it personally? And, you know, if you feel amazing, you will never bring anyone else down.
Right.
You only bring them down because you, the way you feel.
I love that. I want to repeat that. I like to repeat things sometimes.
Right.
Yeah, just for that, just for the absorption, you know? Mm-hmm. If you feel amazing, you will not need to bring other people down. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's simple in its essence, but it's true. And I love that you brought up personalizing. Continue, because, you know, I'm a Don Miguel Ruiz fan, and I go on banging on about the four agreements. And one of his key ones, he said, if you just work with not personalizing, you know, you will change your life forever. But please continue.
Absolutely.
Continue.
So we take things personally.
Right.
And they are never personal. And it's a bit like that, and there's no exceptions to the rule.
Right.
People want to say, but yeah, it was personal. They did it on purpose.
Yeah.
They might have done it on purpose, but they did it on purpose because of how they were feeling. Nothing to do with you.
Right. What people do is not because of you.
Yeah. Exactly. And that's a huge freeing thing to get. And don't get me wrong, sometimes you'll feel, you can still feel it's personal, but then the more you practice letting go on any feeling that it's personal, the quicker your body will realise that's not personal. It feels personal,
yeah,
it's not.
Yeah.
Get it. And it's like Byron Katie did when she started questioning the thoughts. None of the thoughts are true. So if you understand that before you even go into the questioning process, sometimes you need to keep going through it a bit and turning it round, you know, at the end, to really, then you just start laughing, because the enlightenment for her was knowing that none of it was true.
Yeah. Well, so, not even the feelings in that, just to drop in there, because, you know, like, I was listening to that video Emotion recently, and you know I'm big on emotions as well, and it was like, mm-hmm, your feeling, your emotions, should I say, are your integrity. But I'd like to hear, go on, continue what you were saying.
Yes, that's a good, very good point, because the feelings can be created by the thoughts, and the thoughts can be affected by how you're feeling.
Right.
So let's take a hangover, for example. If you wake up in the morning and suddenly you're like, oh, and your thinking goes away down because you're dehydrated, the cells are contracted, blah, 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 blah. So that's a classic example of most people will be able to relate to, of like how you're feeling affects what you're thinking.
Right. Because you're like, man, I feel bad. I'm not going
like, you can hardly cross the road, and you can't make decisions and blah, blah, blah. So it can work both ways. The feelings can bring the thoughts down, and the thinking can bring the energy that we call the feeling in. So, to quote Hale Dwoskin, if it changes, it's not real. What we are can never change. So that with Byron Katie and with the other techniques, it's just being the observer of things that are changing.
Yeah.
And of course the feelings, if we release a feeling, and this is about listening to your intuition. So say, for example, you have a fear that somebody will steal your child. That fear is...
That's a big fear. Uh-huh. Not for me, but people.
Yes, but it's not real.
Yeah.
Let's face it, for most of us, that's not going to happen.
And it just doesn't happen for billions upon billions of people.
So that you can release that fear, and then you'll come to peace with that. If, by any chance, there was an imminent danger, and you release the... A fear, you'll get an inner feeling that you need to do, to change something, or there's an incoming, if you like, because we know that the heart picks up way before the brain does.
Right.
So the heart could be giving you information, you know, pay attention. So there's a difference between a programmed fear that we've picked up from the media, or actually listening to your intuition. It's very rarely that there's danger nowadays. I know for a lot of people on the planet there is a lot of danger. But you're still within that.
But you know when you're in that clearly, right? Don't you? Because
you're
talking about being in a war zone where you know, don't you? Intuitively, when I say to people, we're talking about fight or flight, and we're talking about fear or love, and, you know, fear, false evidence appearing real. Mm-hmm. You know, most fears, unless, you know, you can hear some serious funky noises, or your car's all of a sudden got on fire, or the, you know, the saber-toothed tigers come running after you just when you've gone to the farmer's market, right? It's like, you know, that's fear, yeah? That's like, shit, hold, let's go, Lilia, we got to get out of here, yeah? But ultimately, all the fears which are coming from these stupid thoughts, which is, you used a great example of a woman recently that, you know, or whenever, was projecting how, you know, people were going to come and potentially, you know, cause some harm to children, etc. These are just projected bullshit, basically.
Absolutely. And again, when you start to really understand the kind of quantum physics of how we can change what we see and what we perceive and what we are and where we are, then you realise that you have the power to move away from that fear. And ultimately, that's what I'm teaching, is move from fear to faith.
Nice.
With healing, we're quite literally terrifying people to death.
Right.
And we need to stop doing that.
Right.
And a lot of it is because the suing culture. I need to tell you the worst case scenario just in case I don't, and then you'd say you didn't tell me that.
So you mean again, the suing culture of like, a doctor tells me that, the doctor tells me I've got cancer and I can live a year and I live in 4 months so I can, and the family sues them.
Absolutely. I wouldn't be a doctor for all the tea in China. The stress that they're under.
Yeah.
And people do turn up and, you know, they treat the body any way they want. They live a life of chaos and then they go to the doctor and expect...
Instant healing.
So it's a two-way thing. We need to start saying, right, okay, what can I actually expect the doctor to do? Write me a prescription for a drug, that's really, or send me to a specialist. Or maybe go into hospital and get surgery. You know, there's a limit into what the...
They can actually do, right?
And also from the medical side, we need to start looking at the body as an energy system, a communication system.
Yes.
That's saying, look...
Yeah, I like this.
And it's, so if you... Say, for example, you chose, we have chosen to come here and we agreed that we were going to help raise the consciousness and, you know, help people take responsibility and blah, blah, blah. Say that that was our purpose and we weren't doing that. Then, you know, the cells are like, this is not what we're meant to be doing. There's something wrong here. They don't know what it is.
Right.
They're just responding to a lack of integrity. And I suppose when you look at it, this is where the... sinning thing came from. Sinning's not a thing per se, like don't do this and don't do that. It's like, are you living in alignment?
Right.
As Hippocrates said, are you committing daily sins? You're
not
where you're meant to be.
Yeah, and I love that you've always sort of almost come full circle to are you living in alignment? Uh-huh. And I want you to continue, but it's like, it's something about, because you know I'm all about, as I said earlier, I'm about like, what's the truth, right? The truth of it. And you just touched on that really, that like how Duskin said, underneath, you know, underneath where the observer and watching. And when I say the truth, it's like, I'm always saying to people, you know if you're lying, right? You know if you're aligned.
Yeah, there's something in you. Your body certainly knows.
And your body certainly knows, right? But we don't listen to the body, right? Like when I'm getting people to communicate and share in circles and I'm doing the process that we do, we're saying, listen to the body. And I tell you, nobody that I've come across yet, a couple of okay at it, but like very few listen to the body. They go off into this, I call it the head, I don't even know if it's the head, this thinking, this talking, this, you know, go off, they don't even feel their ankle, you know, and then when they start feeling the body, they start going, oh, my ankle is a bit like painful, that led to, not really, you know what, I've been wearing those shoes that are really bad for, you know, the body starts to say why the ankle is hurting. It tells you, you know, you get pop-ups, same with the stomach, with the gut, with the knee. And I think this is what you mean when you're saying like, embody the intuition, right? It's saying to you what's wrong and what you're really thinking. And the same in the relationship, like what they're really thinking of that person, what they want. I hope I didn't digress there, but you know, it's like, that for me is like listening to the truth underneath.
It's the perfect lead on to the other thing that we realise, that where most people are in a very negative relationship with the body.
Right.
And it's self-judgment, which is the opposite, of course, of self-love. And when you do not love quite literally your cells that you're living in, you are destroying them.
Yeah.
Like us, we all need to be loved and cared for. We need a bit of attention, and that's how we thrive and survive. And I mean that in a healthy way, not in an unhealthy way. But you look at what we're doing to the body now. We're injecting it with stuff. We're filling it up, make the bits to make it look the way we think it should look, because somebody told us. We're spending a whole load of time trying to change it and fix it. And it's
on the outer, right?
Dressing it in a certain way that's not comfortable and not good for it.
Right, and then toxins on the in, and I don't just mean putting down people that are drinking. Exactly. I used to do it myself, but you know, the sugar, you know, you've already said it, but I just want to highlight is sugars, the drinks, the toxins, man, whatever. We go into environments that are toxic, right? Even what the air we're breathing, it just goes on and on and on.
Exactly, and the body's genius. I mean, the very fact that I'm still alive proves that, because I've done a whole load of abusive things to the body.
Likewise.
And the environments I've had it in. But so, you know, it's a pretty hardy, strong
Vessel,
for sure. But eventually it will come knocking, and we understand now that, you know, for me it's not about longevity, it's much more about the energy that you have when we are here. So if you're berating the body for it being too fat, too thin, too tall, whatever it is, boobs too big, you know, the things that we do, the body thinks there's something wrong. It doesn't know what you're thinking, it's having a response to something's not right. And then again, from a healing perspective, if you become sick or if you get diagnosed with an allegedly terminal or incurable disease, then you can be very angry and judgmental at the body, particularly if you're somebody who's looked after yourself reasonably well. And that can happen. You get people that eat right and do all the right things and they still get sick.
Right, and they wonder why.
Yeah, and you know, my belief is that some things are pre-chosen and predestined, and I don't think we really need to go beat ourselves up for why we get sick. I think we need to reflect and look if we really want to heal. But ultimately, if you're getting the diagnosis, why it happened at some in some level is actually irrelevant. It's what do we do now in order to heal? And let's go back to Kelly Turner, who I love her work and so grateful for what she's done. She interviewed, well, it's now thousands of people, but when she wrote her book, which took her 10 years when she was doing her PhD, all the people who defied the odds, who were sent home to die, and the 9 things that they all did. So from drastically, radically changing your diet, herbs and supplements, listening to your intuition, which was a big one that really surprised her, deepening your spiritual connection or your whatever your connection, the fact that we're not in control, you know, there is something higher, and trust and surrender is 2 words that I teach a lot. Let it go, you know, because that's another step, of course, letting go, and just be. Stop resisting and fighting and trying to control, and, you know, because that is what the damage is, the body.
Yeah.
Focus on the positive, okay, and again, of course, when it comes to healing, it's like, open the mind to the possibility that you can. Take control. Now that's a huge one. You need to take control, even within the allopathic system. Be prepared to make decisions all the way along the line, and don't blindly accept everything. Question and feel that there's an element of control, really important for the cells. Have a very strong reason, desire to stay. And this is the challenging thing. If you're diagnosed and you're still got quite high energy, then, or if you've got children or a mission or a purpose, that's maybe easier. But if you feel terrible, you know, at some level, it can be a real challenge to try and make changes. So for everyone and people in Kelly's book, it's a fantastic book. I highly recommend it.
Tell them again, just so they can hear it again.
Radical Remissions.
Remissions by Kelly Turner. Uh-huh. But did you say environment on that one as well? Because I know you're big in environment. Did you say on the environment on the ninth one?
I'd come to taking control and having a strong desire to live. And then the last one is social support.
Right, that's it, super.
So the environment per se is not in there, but if you're listening to your intuition, if you deepen your spiritual connection, and you understand that we are the environment.
And when I meant environment, I meant that social support, which I know you're really, that's a power point, but still.
So let's go back to your vision, say, for naked and seeing this community. Now, if I think, that's a lot of rubbish, you know, he'll never do that, and perhaps maybe people that have known you for a long time and not seen you, they actually can be the worst.
Yeah.
Because they still see you the way you were
20
years ago.
And I
don't mean you, but me as
well. Anyone, me, everyone.
You know, and the members of your family, like, you know, I'm still a hairdresser, you know, not a kind of avid researcher and healer.
Yeah.
So people still see you as they saw you often. So that's why when you can move away to people that support your vision
yeah.
and your beliefs. It doesn't matter what it is you want to achieve.
Right.
The people around you can help or hinder that process.
Yeah, so I want to just say here for people listening, just so you know, we moved on that. We're still on the healing, yeah? What Lilia's pointing out here is that when you want to heal, because heal or create is the same thing, right? If you want to heal, if you're around people that are keeping you, and this is a big thing for me, because people, and especially family, I just want to repeat it, don't let you evolve. They don't let you grow up. They don't let you move into something that you have the potential to be, right? Mm-hmm. And I think that's what happens with healing. With healing, you get diagnosed with something and then almost people are projecting that you're written off, right? But please continue.
Exactly. And this was where the social support network, and my mission right now is to take the fear out of healing. I really strongly believe that people are dying that don't need to. And we need to take these things that Kelly and all these people who have healed have been doing, and we need to bring them to the average Joe Soap who's turning up. And whether you choose to combine these things with taking control and using the traditional allopathic ways, that's your choice. But understanding that there are lots and lots of things that you can do, even within these nine things, there's huge different variations on how you choose to let go. So, you know, who you choose to be around. So getting your inner circle, your support network together and saying, look, this is what I need to do. My body's in a state of emergency and I really, really need to get back on track, and I really would love you guys to be the ones to support me. So can you help me juice? Can you help me get the shopping in? Can you really, if you feel that you can't be part of this, could you just leave? You know, Philly Alexander, an amazing woman who lives in Dundee, she healed herself from breast cancer naturally. And she had somebody came up to her and said, you know, like, you will never heal this with nuts and seeds. And that's the level of opposition you can get.
Yes.
People say, no, you can't do it.
Yeah.
I mean, when you understand the quantum dynamics yeah. of that, you would never do it. But again, that's somebody genuinely concerned thinking you can't.
Yeah.
But she did.
Yes.
But she had to remove that person out of her life. And that's the reality.
Because that's a field, right? You've got to remember, this is a fast energy field, right?
Absolutely.
They're almost coming in as not only the catalyst, but they're bringing that collective field of like, it's not possible, you have to do,
they
you know.
They are affecting and infecting you at a cellular level.
Wow, yes.
So if I didn't support your dream or realise, of course, you can do anything you want, even if you're not saying anything, your energy's there.
Exactly.
I can feel it. My intuition is picking up on it. So, you know, really be careful who, particularly yeah. if your life could potentially be in the line, who you're hanging around.
Right.
And people will always want to help you. They will. And so ask for help and utilise the support and say, look, could you take, if you've got children, can you take my kids? When I'm detoxing, you know, could you really come round every morning maybe and help me? Make
yeah.
sure I'm...
I might be tired.
Yes.
I might be wiped out, you know.
Exactly.
I'm going on a bit of a fast, you know. Can you be there maybe and just like, you know, check in on me?
Love me and support me through this.
Yeah.
We all will, we can grow through fear, but we can grow through love. So
yeah.
What would you prefer?
Well, we can exponentially expand through love, right? But you know, just one thing as you're saying that is that, again, I get these little visions as you're talking, as I often do, but can you see that those nine points that you just pointed out, and I know that you're going into like a real dense area, right? That's why I'm inspired by the decision you've made, you know. It's a niche market because I think people are scared to go there because they're scared of death, right? They're scared of death and change, and they're not going to go there. So I always admire you, and I mentioned Stephen Jenkinson at times, and people that are really working with the people that are dying and so on. But there's that sense of that those nine things work regardless of if you've just been diagnosed with cancer, right? Or because, you know, the way you're talking about, you know, the environment, putting yourself around good people, food, health, you know, and you said something that just made me think as well. It's like, you know, where you're holding on and trying to control, you know, that's happening to people regardless of whether they've got a bloody, you know, just been told they've got cancer. But anyway, I just wanted to highlight that point because I think that what you're doing can serve anyone listening today.
That's what I was going to say. This is the thing. We want to prevent. It's much easier not to get sick than it is to get sick and then try and get well. These things work for everyone. And that's a really good point that I'd been thinking about with, when I went to Sedona to learn how to let go, I went there to find a technique, I thought at this point, to help my clients change their diet. because I could see that people would cry to me, why can't I do it? Why can't I lose weight? And I'm like, why is it that difficult? Why, if you just do this and this, then you'll lose the weight. But I, you know, it mystified me that they just couldn't make the changes. And then, so I went there to get a tool, I thought, to help them change their food. And then when I got there, Hale Dwoskin was in the movie The Secret. And I expected him to talk about The Secret, which he didn't, because The Secret, much as I think it served a lot of people.
It's caused a lot of, it's caused a lot of controversy, right? And frustration. And people are like almost like, no to The Secret now, aren't they?
Because it didn't address the subconscious mind.
Exactly.
And of course, this is what the Sedona method does address. And again, when we look again at this incredible energy field that we are residing in to experience planet Earth, and we are like, wow, this is just magical, amazing, incredible experience. I can have I can call in the energy if I can just believe it. And, you know, so not only is that a healing state, that's an attract, it's the same thing.
Yeah.
So I realized, and I would draw like a cell and, you know, say this is a toxic, dehydrated, you know, cell that's not allowing any light and any light. Thank Barbara Wren for all her amazing work with cellular awakening. And then you've got this other cell that's light and buoyant and hydrated and is full of love. Now, that the two different cells, one is disease. One, you're going to struggle to attract what you want. The other one is health.
It's thriving.
Yeah, which one are you going to be able to attract?
Yeah.
Because everybody knows, and this is something else that I, you know, when you're in a good mood, then things are possible. And when you're in a bad mood, that's when the doubt and the lack of faith comes in.
Yeah.
And it's just the energy that's in the body, the energy that we call emotion that's in the body.
Right.
And it's a great guidance system. You know, Esther and Jerry Hicks talk about the emotional guidance system.
I was just going to mention a minute ago, when you said that they were pointing to the same thing, carry on.
If you feel bad, you're thinking about the wrong thing. If you feel good, you're thinking about the right thing.
Right.
What could be more simple than that?
So that comes into back to linking it into this the alignment again, right?
Exactly, and the contraction and the expansion. We came here to experience this, you know, from a light perspective. It's a pretty magical, incredible place to be.
I know, it's phenomenal.
It's incredible.
Yeah.
And it's just becoming more and more obvious as we learn and expand and as our consciousness rises. But in the meantime, a lot of old stuff's coming up for processing
for
and releasing.
Yes.
Yeah. And if you don't understand that, it can be very confusing and very frightening and it can cause the body intense and immense harm.
And actually to be compassionate and have empathy for that, it's that for people listening as well, because sometimes the viewers are struggling, right? So they're listening to you and I talk today and they're out there struggling. And if you are listening to this and you're having difficulties right now, and hopefully this conversation's brought a little bit of lightness to that. But it's really lovely what you bring up there, because, you know, people can commit suicide. They take their life, right? The pain body, the emotional pain, the contracted cells, they will eat themselves, right? They will kill the host. They will, you know, the depression will lead to, you know, violence. Violence creates war, you know, abuse, beaten up. So you know, just to be really, that's the sort of power we have. The power here to create and manifest and create alignment and joy, isn't it? And the power to create dark depths, suffering, full-blown world wars, you know? That's how powerful we are.
Absolutely. I mean, during the recession which hit the UK, we had a friend who jumped off the Erskine Bridge because he went bankrupt, basically. Now, for me, that's just the most ridiculous thing. It's just money. But for him, it was much more than that. It was, I don't know, obviously, so bad. He felt so bad at whatever level that he took his life, and I know he's not the only one that did that.
Exactly.
That chose the embarrassment or whatever it is that goes
the
with it.
The shame and the guilt that comes with
and
that.
That's all illusionary.
Yeah.
If you'd sat down and talked to your friends and said, look, this is it, nobody cares.
Yeah.
Just like, okay, right, well, I'll pitch in, you can come and stay with me. And it's like,
yeah,
you know, but we're scared to tell the truth.
I love that. Scared to tell the truth. And the truth is the freedom, it's the start. Because actually, and this comes back to the healing of cancers and where you're working in that field, is that actually the disease, you said it at the table, we got there anyway. Well, not that we had to get anywhere, but like the disease is the lie.
Yes.
You said it eloquently this morning over our breakfast.
It's the misalignment. And we know the body tells the truth. So Clive Baxter, a fantastic book, which led me to Sandra Barrett, The Secret Life of Your Cells. So a lie detector. So I put you in a lie detector. You don't need to say a word. Your subconscious will tell me if it's the truth or if it's a lie, because the body reacts, responds to the questions. So we know that the body has that innate ability to lie or to tell the truth. Unless you're very, very well trained, you can't override that.
Yeah.
So we know also that people who, when with the lie detector, a very strange thing happens when they confess. Now, you would expect if somebody's confessing to a murder or a rape or something horrific, they can either get the death sentence or a very stiff jail term, that you would think that their body would get erratic with the fear of that, but the opposite happens. The body goes into a state of relief, which really tells us that that's what the body needs to do. And again, Sandra talked about that, you know, when people confess just to themselves via a letter or a journal, you know, and I think in the AA program they do that as well. You make amends with people that you perceive that you've wronged or people that have wronged you or whatever.
Right. Forgiveness, right?
Let it go. Forgiveness.
Yeah, forgiveness.
Compassion. It's just a bit of energy.
Yeah.
When you realise everything is energy, ain't no exceptions.
Yeah, and in that moment, if you can embody what you've shared in throughout this conversation, but just in moment to moment, that's what I'm always like working with as well. Moment to moment, letting go, right? Because it's like moment to moment, forgiveness, you know, moment to moment, forgiving yourself, loving yourself, bringing in that, you know, that letting go, so you can be in that, like, what did you say? I love that word, relief. The way you said it as well, relief. I felt relieved just seeing you say it. Did you feel that? I was like relieved. I felt relieved in that moment. And, you know, you're letting that go, and then you're interacting with life from that space, yeah? That's how I'm, you know, that's why I do what I do. It's why I, you know, live for transparency, because it's freeing. It gets rid of all trying to remember what you lied about. I lied, you know, when I was younger. It's like trying to remember who you lied to. You know, you're going to get caught out at some point. Mm-hmm. Upholding lies, holding on. It's so tiresome.
Well,
it's boring.
This is why a lot of us are so tired.
Yes.
We're exhausted trying to control. We know at cellular level that energy has, there is no past and no future. There is only now. And Eckhart Tolle's taught us a lot about this. So there is never a problem here and now. It's only when we go back or project forward. And even that is just all perception and projection. It's just not real. So if you can stay in this moment, then it's such a relief.
Yeah, breathe this moment.
Yeah.
Because actually, you know what? You transcend time then.
Of course.
Because when you transcend time, which I know this is what they talk about, but you transcend even the idea of death, which is beautiful when it comes to what you're talking about in allegedly terminally ill, which is allegedly you're going to die soon. Well, actually, if you come to this present moment, it doesn't matter, because you're not thinking, like you said at the beginning, oh, I need to live till I'm 80, so hey, ho, ho, I've got another 50 years. It's like you actually really live now. I love that. That just like booms for me. It's like, yeah, that's actually how you transcend whatever's happening to you.
Well, so many people, you know, when you can actually start to feel gratitude for your time here, and maybe you give up when you have been diagnosed, you start to just go, right, well, I'm not doing that. You know, you take out the things that you're not really enjoying because you think, well, my time's limited. And so many people, you hear that story, it was the best thing that ever happened to them.
Right.
And that's clearly what we should be trying to. The body's just saying, you're out of alignment, things need to change,
yes.
You know, and that's the challenge now, is getting people to believe that they can impact on their health and happiness. Because for me, it is about being happy as well. When you're in that state of acceptance and non-resistance, it feels good. And that's when the body heals.
Yeah, the body heals in that state of feeling good.
Okay, the new.
Listen, these conversations, if you're still with us this far, one, I want to say thank you. super, you know, there's so much information out there today. There's, you know, we can get caught up and lost. And, you know, it's said that people want quick fixes and they want the quick 1 minute, 2 minute like button, the dopamine hit. But if you're with us this far, I want to say thank you so much for staying with us, because this conversation for me, you know, we're going to bring it to a close soon. But, you know, this is a conversation that is not only, I feel, coming through us, but it's one that I feel needs to be had with more and more people, because as Lily has beautifully described in this conversation, you know, we're living in terror. The way that we're being treated when we get diagnosed with illnesses, terminally ill, it's like, it's almost abusive. And we didn't get to share all the stories, but the people that have had the experience of it, you may be one of them, you all know. And it's not to blame the doctors, it's like understand where they are in their constriction and their suffering and their inability to actually have time with anyone. So as we move into sort of closing here, I'd love, maybe it'd be nice, I'd love just from a place of intention as well, and you sort of mentioned it, but how you know, because you know, you want to go to maybe... you know, certain, I don't like the word state, but you know, you want to bring this into the so-called mainstream. You want to take it in there. So maybe as a sort of video projection, it'd be nice for you to hear, like, how do you really see it? And I want to say to people listening as well, something come up beautiful when Lilia a little bit back said about, like, sometimes I get closure and I get my stomach hurts and I get a bit contracted and diseased when I'm also trying to control too much, right? When I'm, because even right now, me and Lilia get buzzed up and we want everyone to know about cellular understanding, right? I'm like, I speak, I'm like, yes, why isn't that in the schools? Why isn't that in the hospitals? Come on, right? And I'm like, oh, full power, yeah? And I'm like, and in that becomes a little bit like, the world must know, you know? And I get into a little bit of my masculine drive and I'm like, yeah. And then I have to check in as well and do my work and do a bit of letting go on that. You know, I wanted to bring it up because sometimes I get, like, it has to be my way, and it's not. So I'm always like, how can I be in this moment with Lilia, hear what's there, allow what wants to come through, the truth to come through uninvited, and be these free-flowing information portals or whatever. Do you see what I'm pointing to? Absolutely. I don't know if that ever comes up for you, because I'm doing work. I do these videos because I want people around the world to change to some extent. So somebody might say, well, sorry, you want everyone to be in love and change, and that's a little bit controlling. So it's how to, like, let go and then still allow, surrender what wants to come through. But you don't have to talk to that if you want to go straight into,
no,
you know.
I absolutely,
yeah,
because I did spend a lot of time in anger, because, and my story is like most people's story, at a personal level, it affected me with my friend's daughter, with my dad, with my mum, with my aunt. I observed it all and I knew that things had to change. And I think the problem is now, before we look to the government to make change, and now we're starting to realise that's not where the change is going to come from. It's not going to come from the government, because there's an agenda always going on there. And then it's not going to come from the pharmaceutical companies. Mm-hmm. And it takes a lot of courage to go out against the system. And I've been working on this stuff for well over 20 years, and I suppose it's only now I've got the courage to actually speak out and say, we need to change this. And and hopefully, between this sort of, I'm talking to lots of different people, because what is the way to do it? I think the internet's a way to do it, but I also understand that people need support. I would like to see a healing oasis in each community. Thinking big, long term.
Good, please put it out there.
Get the healing oasis going on in the way communities used to be, where we looked after and supported each other.
Which people are trying, right? They are trying it. People are out there trying to make this happen.
We need to get back to communities, even the way we're parenting now is so challenging and lonely. We need to get back out and we need to be working as a community. The children get brought up by the collective, and it makes it so that life becomes easier. The government needs to get off our backs, start making things fairer, so that you don't have to have two people working their bones into the ground to cover their overheads. It's just ridiculous. You know, it was never meant to be like that. And we need to cut the whole material crap and start getting to what's real. Come on, people, get the food, you know, let's look after Mother Earth, let's get back to basics and, you know, and be happy. And with, I think some kind of online thing, I'm just looking in a very practical level at creating, helping people to create healing rituals to to do things on a daily basis that will bring the body back into alignment.
Both, if you, regardless of whether you've been diagnosed, but that's what you want to work with as well. Continue.
And I think we all know that. You and I have talked about going onto the roof, you know, every morning and starting your day with that ritual.
Yeah.
And how much better you feel.
Yeah.
And so it doesn't really matter whether you're diagnosed sick or not. There are things that we need to do to keep this energy body healthy on a daily basis. And if, it's like, you know, people used to come into our gym and say, oh, how long do I need to do this for? And I'd say, well, how long do you need to brush your teeth for? You know, to me, it's just such a ludicrous question. But the reality is, if you want to keep it's this, you know, we need to look after this. It's dynamic. It's ever changing. We've got gravity to think about. So what do you want?
Yeah.
You know, and some people are perfectly happy not being very mobile. They just get older and slower and stiffer and they just do less. And that's totally fine. It's not about controlling people and making them do things. This is about people who are actually suffering and maybe don't know that they don't need to.
Yeah. And also I'm going to throw in there that actually, because when I hear you talk, it's also a call. It's what I get from you when you're like today, even in this talk, but the talks we've had, is like I get an invitation. There is a passion there, definitely. There's things that you're not, you know, you've seen and you're clear and you've researched and you're clear that just isn't, that doesn't have to be like that, right? And there's that drive, which I love. But there's also like a call to live. Yeah, it's like, you know, it's a call to live. And it's a call to live because that's also what you've done and are doing, right? Like we don't just preach it. It's not just like preaching and also not just preaching to the converted. It's like we're trying these techniques. You know, I call it the golden hour. I just say that if I don't get up in the morning and my golden hour isn't aligned to some gratitude or more meditation or yoga or smiling or watching something that empowers me, then, you know, I know my day is going a different way. And not to say it might not be good and things might not happen well, but I know that I can take responsibility of that.
That's a very good point. And obviously, I mean, you can see where I live. And I mean, there's not a day goes by that I'm not grateful for this. But I created it. I was very clear about what I needed based on what wasn't serving me, which was being in the house all the time with a television and, you know, not being able to spend a lot of my time outdoors. And that's what I love about Malta. And obviously hanging around with other people that I really grow with that are more expanded and knowledgeable than me. So I'm continuously learning and I feel very at one with, you know, so many of my friends here. So, but everybody can do that.
Yeah.
You know, I'm not saying everybody needs to move to Malta, but you can certainly change if you're willing to let go.
And you could do it in your local community, because you know what? Absolutely. It happened recently to a guy after the naked retreat, Kenny, if you're watching this, Kenny. And, you know, and Kenny had this feeling that he was quite in closure, right? Mm-hmm. Very quick story as we finalize up. And he was thinking that he doesn't have people around him like us and the people that he'd now met on, you know, his family, his tribe or whatever that he was feeling was that, because that's what we get. Oh, there you are. You're here. It's like, we're everywhere, right? It's mm-hmm. like it's you. And then he goes back and he's on this flight. He's got his book out that he was reading, beautiful story. And this woman sees this book and says, oh, that's a nice book. What's that? You know, he starts telling them what it was about. It was about happiness. And anyway, they're only like, you know, in the same damn town. And they've got this like little network. And all of a sudden now he's got like these six new friends, right? He's a couple of women and some other people that he's now meeting up with, hanging out. And that's just expanding on his doorstep.
Yes.
Yeah. I just wanted to throw that in there. Because, you know, often, like you say, it's not about moving. No, I'm not going to move. Why am I going to move? No, but change your frequency, change your attraction. And now probably the next person you walk into the post office, you go, you know what? I live next door. Next door, you know. Yeah. Do you see what I mean? It's that like uncanny.
Because we used to know everybody in the community when not everybody was working,
right?
Or people were working more outside. I'm talking about Scotland here, but nowadays we tend not to even know who our neighbours are. And yeah, you're absolutely right. But it's still about letting go. What is it that you're holding on to that's no longer serving you?
Yeah.
Let it go. Be brave enough to let it go.
And let life come to you.
Dare to think for one second, I can heal.
Yes.
I can have, I can be, I can do. What if?
Mm.
What else is possible?
Ah, let's breathe that in. What else is possible? That's a lovely place to end. I don't know how you feel. I feel stoked up, hungry, pumped up, right? Do you? You know, I'm like, We've had a whole journey, right? We just like, we're using this camera. This is the last time. It's going to be the one of the last sofas filmed on this camera, probably, because we're about to sell this beautiful camera, because as much as you've been a beautiful camera, every 20 minutes I have to restart you. Hence why I've had my phone with me today and we've had to stop. But it's been a beautiful dive, beautiful dance. And I want to just say thank you to my patrons. Thank you to you, Lilia, honestly.
Thank you.
Honestly, super.
No, fantastic.
I hope that, you know, whatever goes on, you, I'm buzzing from your energy. I hope that you're getting a little stoke up from mine.
Oh, absolutely.
And, you know, I just, I feel your integrity. I feel your sincerity. You know, I feel that you're open to just change and exploration and bringing in different ideas, and you're open to collaboration, which is what the sales want. And, you know, and I hope this message, and you continue to do your work, and I know it's already helping. It's like sometimes we take for granted, when you've been letting me stay in your beautiful house, and we take for granted the work that we've done. Mm-hmm. So hopefully if I'm a mirror to tell you, you're doing awesome work, and it's a pleasure to share the sofa with you. I get a little bit tearful for some reason. I get emotional. I might have to let that go. No, I won't. But I want to say to people watching, like, we are alive at such a beautiful time. You know, I'm reprogramming myself because it's a joy. You know, I'm meeting beautiful people along the way, and this is way beyond money and way beyond anything. This is about creating new realities, stepping into new paradigms, new ways of being, new ways of healing, new ways of communicating. This is a whole overhaul. If we're gonna continue as a human species, we require an overhaul. So, and that starts with the individual. The only place you can do the work is with you. You know, the place to love yourself. Like, I love myself so much. Why? I'm with myself the whole time. I can't get rid of me. It's like, if you can't love yourself, who's going to do it for you, right? It's like, what are you going to do? Oi, take the arm, you go over in the corner. It's not going to leave you, right? Love it. And I want to say that being with Lilia this last week has made me love myself even more. And I read a beautiful book by Don Miguel Ruiz that brought into this thing about loving every single cell. Yeah, loving every single cell, that's 60 to 100 trillion, whatever, whoever's counting. And like loving every single part of your body. And I've been doing that. And this week, again, another drop with Lilia to go, wow, yeah, the intelligence of the cells. Mm-hmm. I'm loving the intelligence of these cells now.
The awesome inner verses.
Right. Mm-hmm. I've fallen in love with the intelligence of the cells, you know. And you brought another like little drop to that, you know, that just plugged me in. So anyway, I'm buzzing on that. I hope you are. Share if you feel inspired to have these conversations with people around you. Underneath the video, there will be a link to Lilia's website. If you have any questions, anything that you might have heard, a mention of a person, a book, and you know, you want to ask Lilia something, please go to her website, drop her a question, and get in touch. Yeah, it's an open invitation, right?
Thank you.
So as always, you know what I get? I get all the hugs. I hope you guys watching this can enjoy the hugs that I get, because I enjoy them, right? It's